Hey guys and gals, mixing it up a little bit today on today's Carrot Cast. I go on a lot of podcasts, and one thing we're going to be doing a lot more is going on podcasts outside of real estate. And there's something really, really exciting about that. I love sharing, you know, what we're learning as entrepreneurs. And this podcast is actually a recording from the High Income Business Writing Podcast. So that is actually a podcast that is aimed at writers, at people who are freelancers, people who are going after and creating businesses out of their skill around writing. But the reason that I wanted to play this episode with you, with Ed Gandia and myself, where Ed interviewed me, is we talk about Carrot. We talk about lots of business things, mindset things. We talk about just how to look at life and how to look at things successfully. Also, we talk about if you are a consultant, which I know a lot of our clients are consultants or they do lots of other different types of work. We talk about how to increase your prices and how do you really charge what you're worth. So hopefully this is kind of a little bit of a good departure for you in the Carrot Cast and gives you a little bit of a different perspective on business and mindset and lifestyle. If you love the podcast and love the way that the Ed interviews, please, please, please head over to his podcast. Go find it on iTunes. It's called High Income Business Writing with Ed Gandia, G-A-N-D-I-A. Throw him some support because I appreciate the heck out of him bringing me on the podcast. So here it is. Check out this episode of the Carrot Cast. If you're brand new to the podcast, if you're brand new to the Carrot Cast, every single Tuesday we roll out a new episode, usually they're coming from inside a carrot, you know, our thoughts, our case studies or interviews with other investors and what they're doing great, and also kind of the struggle and the wins and the journey of being an entrepreneur from inside of my head, okay? So go find us on iTunes, subscribe over there, you get access to these podcasts at least a week before we ever release them on our blog. And this one, like I said, is a little bit different, so hopefully you enjoy it. See ya.
Welcome to the High Income Business Writing Podcast, helping you propel your writing business to a whole new level. And now, here's your host, Ed Gandia.
Hey there, welcome to the High Income Business Writing Podcast. I am your host, Ed Gandia, and this is the podcast for business writers and copywriters who want to earn more in less time doing work they love for better clients. You can find detailed show notes for this episode at b2bluncher.com/episode142. Those notes include a summary of our discussion as well as any links to resources we mentioned during the show. Many of us spend time at the end of the year setting goals for the months and the year ahead. But have you ever sat down to figure out what you value most in your business and your personal life? And more specifically, I'm talking about the values, criteria, or rules, if you will guide most of your decisions. I know I think about those things occasionally, but until I talk with my guest for this episode, I'd never considered formalizing this process in order to end up with a clear set of non-negotiables for my business and my personal life. And today you're going to hear from Trevor Mock. And Trevor is a very successful entrepreneur who started just a few years ago, just like many of us did, as a freelancer. He was a marketing professional, a consultant. And he eventually founded a software company that's grown into a multi-million dollar business. Now, along the way, Trevor had a series of challenges and epiphanies that changed the course of his life. And in this episode, he's going to explain how clarifying his own set of non-negotiables made all the difference in the world. This is one of those topics that are perfect for this time of year, when we're reflecting on the year that's passed and the year that's ahead. And I hope you find it inspiring and thought-provoking. Enjoy. Hey, Trevor, great to be talking with you today. Thanks for coming on.
Ed, thanks for the invite, man. And like we were saying before we hopped on here, this is one of the things that I love the most about what I get to do in business today. So I appreciate you bringing me on here to chat with your audience today.
Absolutely. This is a great topic, and I'm anxious to dive in. And before we do, though, why don't you give us a little bit of background? Give us some context. You know, what do you do today? What's your background? You know, where did you come from? Give us the backstory.
Yeah, man. So going real micro here. So I live in a small town in Oregon called Roseburg, grew up in Oregon. But after college, you know, so I became an entrepreneur actually in college. And I'm in real estate specifically, started buying investment properties, but I've always loved marketing. I've always loved building businesses. I've always loved going out there and how can I provide value with my knowledge base and with my knowledge set to other people, specifically businesses. And so after college, well, I had some rental properties. We moved up to Portland, my wife and I, and I started to go out there on my own. I started to go out there and be a freelance marketing consultant and realized I had no clue what I was doing that first year, year and a half. And fast forward through today, and that's some of the stuff we're going to talk about in this podcast, is kind of in that gap period between the time that I'd started off as a marketing consultant, a freelance marketing consultant, to the time, you know, we're a point where we are now, where I have a SaaS company, a software as a service business that is well into the multiple millions a year. We have 16 full-time employees. I know most of the people on this call probably aren't looking for that. But the cool thing is that the perspective I've got on being a freelancer to growing and scaling, I can really show you my experience on how to really best set up a business that that suits your goals, that suits your passions and your purposes. And that's really what we're talking about here, Ed, is we're saying everyone's different. Everyone's got different passions. Everyone's got a different purpose for being here. How do you make sure you suit your business to that? And that's what we're going to be talking about.
No, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. A lot of people think, well, you know, freelancers, you know, that's not really a business. And one of the core concepts that we really hit on here and most of what I put out is you got to treat it as a business, even if it's a business of one. So that's really cool that you've had this perspective and you understand where we're coming from. So why don't you tell us a bit about that journey, the struggles that you had that eventually led you to this idea of setting these key non-negotiables that we're going to be discussing today. I want to hear a little bit of the backstory of how that came about.
Man, it's so funny. So in any time there's a big change in life, let's say you get married, there's the honeymoon period, right? I think as entrepreneurs, there's a honeymoon period too. A lot of freelancers, they became freelancers because it was their side hustle, or they left the job and then they started freelancing. And during that time, that was, you know, after college, it was kind of a really cool honeymoon period for about 2 to 3 years for me, as I was going, okay, all my friends, they have jobs. They're out there having jobs. They think it's awesome. I think that's not awesome because you don't control your destiny, I feel. Unless you can really control your client base and control what you're offering them. And so during that period, I'm out there, you know, hustling, trying to get clients here and there, failing more than I was succeeding. The first year in business, I made about $16,000 as a freelancer.
Nice.
Yeah, paid everything on my credit cards. I actually paid my taxes on my credit card that year, which I didn't know you could do, and I don't suggest you do, because it's expensive. They charge you the extra 3 or 3.5% or whatever it is to cover the credit card fees. And that first year, man, I was just trying to figure out the basics of it. You know, it was like, how do you actually provide value to people? You know, how do you market? How do you go out there and crack through that clutter? Because no one was wanting to buy any of these marketing services I had, because I wasn't someone who was a famous marketing consultant. I was just some dude who came and said, hey, here's these things I can do for you. And so that first year was all about that, man. It was the foundations of just how do you hone in on what it is that you want to offer, what it is that you are good at and can be great at. And then next, you know, it was like, how do I actually provide value to people? So that was the first year and a half or so. And as soon as I flipped this switch in my brain, which is about 8 to 12 months through that first year, just really not making any money. I had a lot of fun. I was still in the honeymoon period. So I wasn't down and out. You know, I knew without a shadow of a doubt that this was going to work. I just didn't know when it was going to work. It wasn't a matter of if, but when. And so I wasn't selling stuff already. So I just said, you know what, let me just go out there and just find my ideal clients. And I'm just going to do work for them for free. And I'm already not getting paid, hustling to try to sell some marketing consulting work. And let me just go find my ideal clients, go find some things I know that I can help them with on their website or over here, or over there. I'm going to pitch it to them and I'm going to say, hey, I'm not asking for any payment here. I just know that this is something that you need to change in your website. It's going to improve things going this way, or I can dig in and do this for you. I could drive some backlinks to them and get the ranking higher or whatever. And I did that with a couple of them. And what happened was, by me shifting that value equation in my head from how can I go out there and sell something and get mine to how can I help them get theirs and not ask anything in return. I can just do that for experience. It opened up these doors to some clients I never would have been able to sell a marketing contract to. Never. Because I went out there and said, hey, let me provide value. I showed them the value, didn't ask for anything. Then they said, hey, I don't feel good about not paying you, and I want you to do more of that. Can we work together? And so then that led into that second phase, which is that second year of me actually making some money. So I think I made 30 or 40 grand that year as a freelancer. But the non-negotiables, this is where this came in, is that first couple of years, like I said, was a honeymoon period where I was trying to figure out the basics of it. Everything was exciting at that time. Everything was exciting. You know, even though there were a lot of failures, it was all exciting. And it was probably about this was 2010. After I had launched another business on the side, I was still doing marketing consulting, but then I started to do publishing online, publishing content. I had a blog, found out how to generate leads and traffic. And we actually ended up publishing training courses and books and things like that. And during that phase is when I discovered what I did not want out of a business. You know, during that honeymoon phase, I realized, man, this is great, but this income is boom and bust. I can't have a boom and bust income, because that's stressful. It's stressful not knowing with pretty good clarity what your income is going to be next month.
Yeah, because you're still selling at that point mainly professional services, right? Marketing consulting, and you might have a great couple of months, and then that engagement is done, and now you're looking for the next one, right? So it's that variable income that can be maddening.
Yeah, it's the variable income, and also like once we shifted over to selling information online too, through training courses and books and stuff like that. Even that was a boom and bust business model for us, because we didn't find and make ways. We didn't make it intentional to create something that is one of my non-negotiables I'll introduce here, of having something that is consistent and predictable. You know, there's so much value to having consistency and predictability in your income stream in life. And it adds so much flexibility. I know we all become entrepreneurs in one way, shape or another. Because flexibility is one of those things you're looking for. You know, it's the F's, it's the freedom, flexibility, finances. There's probably some more F's in there somewhere, but you become an entrepreneur because of those. And what happens is our income model, our revenue model, prevents us from gaining the freedom and the flexibility and the finances, because we're out there just going after these one-off things the whole time that, like you said, expire after a couple months or 6 months, or you sell something one time and it's over. So during that period where I had the publishing company, I was still doing marketing consulting on the side. I'll walk through a couple ways here in a bit on how I basically took what I was able to charge someone from this to about 10 times that and deliver more value and attract the right client. I'll talk about that here in a bit. It took the same amount of time to do the work, but I was getting paid 10 times more by this time. But during that phase, after that honeymoon, I'm like, man, I was waking up in the morning, and this is, you know, like, so this is 2010. We had our first daughter. I've got three kids. Today they're 3, 5, and 7, amazing kids. But McKinley, our oldest, was born in 2010 in August. And I remember vividly, you know, in the spring of 2010, summer of 2010, even after she was born, waking up in the morning and really just not wanting to get out of bed to tackle the day that I had created for myself and my business. I wasn't excited about the work that I was actually doing every day. There wasn't something that was connecting me at my core to be excited about doing that work. Was I good at the tasks? I was pretty good at some of those things. And I think that can really trick people. When you're good at something, and maybe even if that something brings in money, it can oftentimes trick us that that's what we should be doing more of.
Yeah, so true.
And that to me was a big thing, because in that period, writing email copy, you know, being the marketing guy, executing on the marketing stuff was what made us money. What really charged me up and excited me was this kind of stuff, was teaching the things that I'm passionate about and coaching great people, coaching great leaders. I really love strategy, but I hate implementation. I didn't realize it then. And 95% of my day was implementing stuff, and very little of it was strategic. And so during that phase of that business, we ran that for about 2.5 years with my business partner. I finally came to this period in 2012. So it was about a year and a half of me living life that way, where I was making okay money, you know, low six figures a year for me personally. Still had consulting on the side, had this publishing company, had investments in a few software companies that two of them went out of business, one of them still alive that is doing great now. And I woke up one day and I'm like, man, a friend of my brother's, my older brother's 3 years older than me. He was 34 at the time and, three kids was in his backyard and he was doing yard work, you know, it was on a Sunday and, him and his wife earlier that day were talking about the future as oftentimes you do as families, right? Hey, you know, it's going to be really cool 20 years out when it's like this, or just kind of thinking about that stuff. And he had a brain aneurysm. And, while they were planning out, you know, 20 years out earlier that day, they didn't know that he wasn't going to be there for dinner that night.
Wow.
And yeah, man. And that hit me hard. That hit me hard. Cause at that time I had a couple kids, you know, our second was born in 2012. I was in this period of my business and life where I was doing work. I was making okay money. It wasn't crazy consistent. It was still boom and bust, but I'm like, man, I don't have the urgency in my life that I really need to be happy. I don't really have the urgency in my life that I really need to go out there and make great things happen for me and other people. And it kind of became this mission where it's like, man, Nick, you know, he's the one who passed away. Nick doesn't have any more time to do this. Like every second that I'm wasting feeling sorry for myself or doing the wrong activities or doing a business that I'm not fully passionate about and something within that business is pushing forward my purpose. I'm like, man, I'm just going to part ways with everything I'm doing that doesn't fit that mold. And out of that came these non-negotiables. I sat down about a month after that happened. I said, all right, I'm going to sit down and write down a list of all the things that are 100% non-negotiable that have to happen with my business. Otherwise, I'm either not going to run the business or I'm going to shift the business immediately to where it fits these, or I'm going to shut the business down. If any of my businesses ever don't fit these again, it's going to be shut down or I got to shift it. And I'll kind of read through the non-negotiables here and talk about why these were important to me. And I think that a lot of these will apply to other people, whether you're a freelancer, you're just getting going, or you're wanting to build momentum and add consistency, or maybe you are wanting to scale. But the things that I sat down and said, you know what, these things absolutely have to happen. Otherwise, I'm not going to waste time in my life doing this business, are these. The number one was singular focus on the big thing. I think as entrepreneurs, whether you're a freelancer or you run a bigger company, and Ed, I think you can relate to this. Once we have a little bit of success in doing something, let's say you lock down your first client that actually paid you money, or you are able to repeat it a bunch of times, you go, man, I can do the same thing over here. And man, I can really provide a lot of value over here. You see opportunity everywhere. You see it everywhere.
You do.
And I think it's a blessing and a curse, right? Because those of us that are entrepreneurs, because we see opportunity, because we're not out there being pessimistic about everything, we see the world through our eyes in a better light than most people do. We just do. So opportunity comes natural to most of us. But for many of us who, I'm not sure if you've taken the Kolbe score before, K-O-L-B-E, the Kolbe.
Oh, yeah, the Kolbe A. Yeah, it's brilliant.
Dude, so what are you? Are you a high quick star?
I'm very high quick star. Yeah, I'm a 5-6-9-1.
Okay, sweet, dude. So 5-6-9-1. So the 6 is follow through, 9 is quick start. So you're like almost as high as you can go on quick start, which for everyone listening to this that has not taken the Kolbe test, it kind of grades the way that you work. And it's not grade. It's not a right or wrong. It's like, here's the way that you naturally tend to work. And high quick starts are visionary. You're okay with things changing. You're okay with, you know, having multiple things halfway done. I'm a 5-2-8 something. I can't remember what the fourth one is. So I'm really low on follow through, really high in quick start. Therefore, I've got 4 halfway read books on my nightstand right now. Like I do. At that period of my life, I had investments in 2 software companies. I had the publishing company. I had 4 or 5 consulting clients. I had an entrepreneur co-work space, which we still have. That's why I'm doing this. Real estate investments. And you start to look at this and go, oh my gosh, that sounds amazing, but it was a nightmare. So I wasn't able to do my best at any one of them.
Yeah, just everything sounds good. You know, oh, that sounds great. You need to do that. And that sounds really good too. And I happen to be really good at it. So I should pursue that and I should do more of this. And it starts becoming, you're diluting your efforts and your talents, right?
You are. And the thing is that so many people, like once they see that you're good at something, you get a lot of people reaching out to you to want to engage you, right? Which that's a good thing. Normally, that's an amazing thing to have people reach out to you where you don't have to go and do a bunch of marketing to engage you on something. So I was still in that period where there was the scarcity mindset a little bit, to where it was really hard to get clients at the start. Now it was really easy. So therefore, I must take all these clients on, or I must take all these projects on. And so at that point, I'm like, man, you know what? This next year, I'm going to give myself the pass. I'm going to give myself the okay to focus on one big thing. That's it. I'm going to shed everything else in my business life off except for one big thing. So that's that first non-negotiable, is singular focus on the big thing. Singular focus on the big thing. And it's not saying that we can't add multiple things as we go, but I think the mistake that many of us make is we add on another thing before we've systemized the first thing. You know, before we've made the first thing consistent, predictable, built a team or systems around it that require less of your time. And if you don't do that with the first things and you keep on adding more things, it's just going to lead to stress and, you know, delivering a mediocre result.
Yeah, I found that most of us are way too optimistic as to how much we can accomplish with any one of those things. And mm-hmm. we don't realize that just to do them well and for them to, like you said, to be systemized and actually doing delivering value without too much of your time and attention, that takes time. That takes more effort than we realize. So we end up having all these things that are kind of half finished. Or not even there. And then we get frustrated when, you know, none of them are really yielding what we need them to yield.
Mm-hmm. And it's so funny, man. So around this time, and we'll move on to non-negotiable number two here in a second, but around this time, I read this book called The Pumpkin Plan. And have you ever read The Pumpkin Plan?
I have not. I've heard of it. I know it's supposed to be a great book.
Dude, it's a great book. And Mike McAllowitz, the author, is going to kill me for saying this, but... So it's one of my favorite books of all time, and I haven't made it past chapter one. Now, I know that sounds really funny. Dude, I've referred that book to hundreds of people. I've bought hundreds of copies of that book and sent them out to people, because the difference that the concept, he wrapped a very normal thing into a very simple concept that connected me in my brain. And this is a great marketing lesson, number one. But number two, it was, I think, page 16 of the book. You can actually get the first chapter for free. Just go online and type The Pumpkin Plan PDF. And Mike's got the first chapter up on his website, and you can read that first chapter. And the rest of the book is amazing, I hear. But the first chapter, and that's the way that my high quick start goes. As soon as I get what I needed out of that, I shut it and I move on. And page 16, I think it's page 15 and 16 did it for me. And basically what he does is he walks through this analogy of a pumpkin farmer, and those people who grow those world champion, huge, huge, huge pumpkins you see on TV. The guy asked, he said, it was in a newspaper article. He's like, you know, how do you grow these world-class giant pumpkins? And the farmer walked through the basic process, and Mike read it and goes, oh my gosh, that is so applicable to business and life. And the basic process is this. Number one, you got to have a great seed. The seeds that grow these giant pumpkins aren't the normal seed. You got to have a great seed. And so with business, what is the great seed? It's a great idea. You have to have a great idea. It can't be just the run-of-the-mill idea. But oftentimes the cool thing is you plant multiple seeds. You're not just planting one seed, right? Mm-hmm. So if you're trying to grow that massive pumpkin, you don't just go, oh my gosh, here's this one seed. I think it's a pretty good seed, but I'm just going to plant this and see what happens. In the starting phase, when you're getting going, you should be planting seeds everywhere. Plant some seeds, see what catches, see what takes. And then the next thing that the farmer does is they water the heck out of that seed, right? Plant it in good soil and water the heck out of it. And after a period of weeks, you know, you're going to see those seeds sprout, and you're going to see those 5, 6, 10, whatever it is, pumpkin vines going out there. And he said, pretty soon you're going to be able to see on the pumpkin vines where some pumpkins are growing. And he goes, pretty much go through that pumpkin vine and trim off everything that's not a pumpkin at that point. Trim off leaves, trim off everything that's not a pumpkin, because those are zapping the nutrients from going to the pumpkins. And then he said, as you go, you're going to see some pumpkins that are bigger and have more promise. Cool. Those are the ones you're going to now focus on. Trim off every small pumpkin on that vine. So now all the nutrients go towards those bigger pumpkins. And then eventually you're going to see one pumpkin that just seems to be outperforming the others. And he said, at that point, ruthlessly go on that pumpkin vine, trim off every single leaf, every single other pumpkin, so there's nothing left but the vine and that one pumpkin at the end of it. And you water the heck out of it. And he said, towards the end, those final days before the competition, the farmer says you can almost physically see the pumpkin grow in that last week. And man, as soon as I heard that, that hit me so hard because I had a bunch of pumpkin vines. I had a bunch of pumpkins on there thinking I was all cool because I had a million things going. But that year I said, okay, I'm going to pick the one pumpkin. I'm going to focus on it this year. I'm going to figure out what that is in the first few months. And then I'm just going to water the heck out of it that year. And if that's the thing that takes off, cool. At least I gave myself the shot that I focus on it for that 1 year. And if that wasn't the one, then I'll switch and do something else. And that one became Carrot, which is our business today. And it's grown insanely fast. And it's been my number one focus for the past 3.5 years. The second non-negotiable is have fun and have a big mission I believe in at my core. So this is one trap I fell into, and I think a lot of entrepreneurs do, is originally when you launch a business, most of the time it's about the income, I'd say. You know, it's about the income and freedom. You're wanting to leave a job, or you want to have the flexibility to travel, or whatever it is, or you think there's a bigger opportunity for earning income. And I know that was mine. I think out of college, it wasn't per se really the income that was my main driver. It was that I just didn't want to be tied down by a job. I wanted to kind of do my own thing. And the income was obviously a good thing that attracted me. It's like, hey, there's no cap on your income as an entrepreneur. But the one thing that I didn't do very well in those businesses, those first 3-4 years, was I didn't really have much fun. You know, I was out there hustling all the time. I was out there doing good work, but we didn't bake fun into it. And at the end of the day, when you see something happen to a dear friend of yours, like I did to my brother's friend who passed away young, I'm going, man, life is way too short to not have fun every day in business. You know, it doesn't matter if you sell toilets. It doesn't matter if you're I don't care what business it is.
Yeah, we need to have fun. It's got to really jazz you up, and you got to wake up at least most days feeling like, yeah, I want to do this, right?
Exactly. And I think the key that you said there, Ed, was most days, because no matter, I mean, you look at guys like Richard Branson or some of those guys that look like they're having amazing fun, Elon Musk, right, with the filtered versions of their lives through social. They make a lot of fun into their businesses, but there's, I mean, 100% guarantee they wake up many days also just with days that aren't very fun because they've got to run a business. They've got thousands of employees or tens of thousands. So you got to make sure to know, okay, fun should be in a massive part of your business, but not every day is going to be that way. So you got to stick through those ones.
But, you know, let me interject real quick. There's something for me, the litmus test was two very simple things. Sunday evenings, looking forward to Mondays. That I didn't set that as a goal, but I'd started noticing for me, you know, I'm really looking forward to tomorrow. I'm ready. I'm really excited about what's coming. And number two was I would get very depressed at the beginning of the year. It's a post-holiday blues. And, you know, now you're starting on a clean slate. And I came from sales, so now you're starting all over, right? All the quotas have been reset. And years, I would be really depressed the first 2-3 weeks of January. So when that changed and I started feeling really excited to get back at it, that's another thing that just told me right away. Yeah, this is cool. I'm where I should be.
Dude, I love that so much. And here's a couple of things that we did with Carrot, our current company. So once again, these non-negotiables are leading into the business I'm running today that fits me, my passions, my purpose in life. And man, we make a whole line of dolls. Like we've got, I think, 5 or 6 dolls now. We call them Carrot Buds, but there's one which is our original Carrot doll. And we've got Farmer Carrot and Super Carrot, who's like wearing a Superman suit. And we've got Agent Carrot now because we're rolling out a product for real estate agents. And we've got some other rolled out Carrot Gal, who's our first Carrot Girl. We have a coloring book, a kid's coloring book that teaches our core values in a way that kids can understand. That's coming out in about a month and a half. We ordered Santa Claus hats for our carrots that are going to be here in about a week. We're going to start doing some fun things with. We send some of our partners and customers fun stuff. So what can you do as a freelancer, even if you're a one-person shop, to have fun with your clients? You know, send that client something fun in the mail. Back when I was a solo person, I had a couple of VAs that were doing some work for me. One of them was in New York. Her name is Christina, and she's awesome. Every now and then, you know, it seems like probably every couple months, she was just crushing it with stuff all the time. I'd send her a $50 gift card to go have ice cream with her kids, or I'd find out what she's passionate about and what she loved. And I'd gift things because it was fun to do that. So as a freelancer, find things that you can do to have fun in your business. It doesn't have to be that you have to have a business that on the outside is inherently fun. Software and real estate is not inherently fun. You can make anything fun if you want to.
That's creative. So, I love that.
Yeah, man. And the second part of that was a big mission. This is something that I don't want people to beat themselves up over, this part of it. But I know purpose and passion, you know, is such a big topic, as it should be with people, entrepreneurs especially, because we're more motivated. It seems more ambitious than the general crowd out there. But we all want to feel like we're waking up in the morning for something that matters in this world. You know, we all want to feel that what we're doing is making a difference more than just putting food on our table. And there's this kind of trend that happens as an entrepreneur. At first, you're motivated by the income and money because your back is probably against the wall, or you've got a job you don't like, or whatever it is, and you've got to go out there and create the income so you don't have to do what you were doing before. But once you get to the point to where the income is taken care of and you're at least meeting your needs, maybe a little bit more, the income becomes a lot less important without a mission. And I know for me, with my previous business, we made a good income. You know, we made more money than I was spending. So at the end of the day, the money was just going in the bank. And when you wake up in the morning, you see money going in the bank that you're not using anyway, and you're doing work, you're going, why am I doing this? You know, the value equation of the extra money in your bank account diminishes as it gets higher, unless you have a mission that requires more growth. Mm-hmm. And so that's one thing that we did here at Carrot Big Time is I didn't, dude, from day one, I wanted to build a business that did 30 to 50 grand a month with Carrot. And I'm like, once we get to that point, it'll be sweet. This will be a lifestyle business. And then we can also really use this to inject, you know, to really amplify part of my mission locally here in Roseburg, Oregon, to improve rural entrepreneurship and starting in Oregon and moving across the states, because I really believe in rural. I really believe that rural is an amazing place to start and grow businesses of almost any type. And so that was kind of my mission with that. And I'm like, once we get up to that revenue, then I can really go in here and invest and do micro investments in some businesses here and really help to build some good culture and community. And the funny thing is, as we started to put mission out there like that, and we started to put it out there and started to do great product, we grew and we grew and we grew. And today we're doing, you know, almost 400,000 a month. Wow. And it's not because of the finances, we grew because our mission required us to. That over the course of starting Carrot, the first year, the challenge was, can we prove a product and make it work? The second year was, can we cement ourselves into this market and really start to dominate the market? The third year transition was really, it's like, man, what are we passionate about on the impact side of things? And I'm not going to dig into that side of it a whole lot, but there's something at our core, at my core, I wake up to every day with this business, knowing that the bigger we get, the more impact I can make in that area. And the money just happens to be a byproduct.
You know what? I'm glad you were very honest about how you evolved to that point, because I know for a long time I felt weird about this whole idea that I didn't really have a mission. And it's because mm-hmm. at first you're just trying to make a living, right? You just, like yeah. you said, your back's up against the wall and you're just trying to get to a certain level so you can feed your family. But at some point, you have to pivot in that area, and you have to crystallize mm-hmm. that. Otherwise, it's very dangerous. Your lifestyle will quickly grow to that same level of income, and it'll be a constant treadmill. So I think it's two things. One is just kind of holding tight, living well, but, you know, just making sure things don't get out of control, and then taking the time to think about what is your mission? You know, what this is bigger than you. How can you impact your community and the world? And it may come to you right away. I know for a lot of people, it takes several weeks or months for the answer to emerge.
Or years. You know, for me, it was years, because I know with my previous business, we were doing great work, and we had started doing the local entrepreneurship culture building with my previous business. And that's always been a mission of mine the past 5, 6, 7 years, is how can we amplify Roseburg specifically and really tell the Roseburg story all throughout Oregon, which we've done that in a massive way, and we're getting even better at it. Actually, this Friday is our fifth, I think, investor conference, where we've invested about $700,000 into five businesses over the past 5 years in Oregon. And that's something we started 5 years ago. So this is something that has been a part of what I've been doing, and we baked that into Carrot also. But yeah, I think things evolve. And I think one thing here, Ed, that I'll toss this out to people, depending on the phase that you're in, then I'll go through the rest of the three non-negotiables here in a quicker pace, because I know we're nearing the end of the call. But is during that period where I pared things down in 2012, where I said, hey, you know what, I'm going to simplify my life and focus on, let me give myself the credit of focusing on one thing and seeing how good I can do with it this year without distraction. Another thing I also did that year was I said, you know what, I'm also going to stop beating myself up about my purpose. Because for years, I'd put a purpose on the wall thinking it was cool. I can inspire a million entrepreneurs, blah, 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 blah. That all sounds cool. And I'm not saying that's not worthy. And many people, that is their purpose. But for me, it didn't hit me in my core. And I think one thing that I have found anyway, that's a good indicator of whether you're on purpose or whether that is your purpose, is where subconsciously you're baking almost everything you do on a daily or weekly basis into this thing, whether you know it or not. For me, I love amplifying leaders, because I know that leaders and entrepreneurs are the people that are really the change agents. I know that they're the people changing communities. They're the people going out there and solving the problems. So how can I amplify leaders? That's why I'm on this call. You know, most of the people on this call are not, our customers will never pay me a dime ever, but that doesn't matter to me, because I get fired up about amplifying the people on the other end of this call, so they can go out there and make their bigger difference. It's the butterfly effect side of things.
Love it.
That hits me at my core, dude. Like, I love that. So find something that hits you at your core. You'll know it when you start to bake that into everything you're doing. The conversations you have, you're excited about, find out why you're excited about it, because there's probably some part of your purpose in there. The next thing is, if you're beating yourself up over it and can't find your purpose, give yourself permission for a year to not find your purpose. And that's what I did in 2012. I said, you know what? I'm just going to give myself permission this year that my purpose is this one thing. At the end of the year, I want to look back with conviction and say that I did the best I could possibly do as a human being at everything in life that year. I did the best at the small things. I did the best at the big things. And the only way I could do the best is if I focus in. And so that was my only purpose that year. It was like, I'm not going to look for my purpose this year. I'm not going to beat my head over on a wall over it. I'm going to look back at the end of the year and feel good that I did the best I could do as a human being. And there's a few reasons why. Like, at that time I had a couple kids, and so you start to adopt new schedules as you have kids, of course. And I wasn't the best person, like, in general. Yeah, I wasn't the best father I could be. I wasn't the best husband I could be. I wasn't the best entrepreneur I could be. None of that stuff. I wasn't the best friend. So I remember vividly one time I opened up my dresser drawer, and I'd give myself excuses for years that I was just a kind of a messy person, because I had a messy room when I was a kid, and my mom wasn't the cleanest of people. I mean, she's very, very clean, but she kind of allowed us to have dirty rooms, kind of, so made it okay. Uh-huh. And so as an adult, I always kind of wanted to have my space, right? My wife is insanely clean, but I'm like, oh, babe, just let me have my space. You know, it's kind of the way I am. And just let me have my closet, my drawers, and my truck. You know, that's kind of what it was. And so I open up my dresser drawer one day, and it's just a mess, my shirt drawer. And immediately in that moment, it popped in my brain and said, this isn't the best I can do. So I dumped everything out of my drawer, got rid of half my clothes, folded my shirts, printed shirts on the left, plain shirts with no print on the right. And it's been that way ever since. That was 2012. So 5.5 years later, 2-3 weeks later, my closet opened up. This isn't the best I can do. And I got rid of half the clothes in my closet, nothing on the floor anymore. My closet's still that way today. And so that, to me, is something I'll pass along to people. If you're banging your head against the wall to find your purpose, you need to declutter your life and do the best you can do at everything first. And that so opened up my mind that year to where my purpose was in front of me the whole time. I just didn't notice it because I had so much clutter in my life, personally and business. And once I decluttered everything and did the best I could do as an individual, my purpose kind of just fell in my lap. And it was pretty amazing.
Wow. So you have to, you have to give it the right space for it to surface.
Give it the right space. So number three, consistent and predictable. We talked about that a little bit ago, is the boom and bust business model is just really stressful. So try to find a way to create consistency, to create recurring income in there. If you're a freelancer, can you lock someone down to a 12-month contract? So we here at Carrot, we do have some services that we offer. We only sell the ongoing services in 12-month contracts with people. While a lot of people are doing 3 or 6 month contracts for, let's say, pay-per-click marketing or something, we will not do it for under 12 months. And We do lose some clients that way, which is fine, but then we gain consistency and predictability. So find ways to make your business consistent, predictable, get off of the boom and bust business treadmill. You're going to be a lot happier. I can right now tell you with 98% certainty what my income will be in December next month. And that's pretty darn awesome having that feeling. I can go on vacation and know that it's going to keep on coming in. I can plan. You can actually plan out hires or having people help you when your income's consistent and predictable. The next thing, build a long-term valuable asset. This is one thing I think a lot of people are guilty of. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but we get so into the transactional side of business. Let me do this transaction. Let me do this bit of work. Let me do this and let me do this one. And at the end of the day, you're a year, two, three, four, 5 years in, and you've done a lot of transactions, but you haven't built a business. You haven't built something that is of any more value than the active contracts you have at that point. And I'm not saying that everyone aspires to build a business. A lot of people are insanely happy with being a freelancer, making the extra income on the side, which is amazing. If that's it for you, do that. Dive in full, you know, full steam with that. But for a lot of people, you want to make sure that what you're working on is actually building momentum. It's building something that someday could be worth something. Maybe you would want to sell it. Maybe it's something that you can bring in another team member to work on with you because it is something that is building something valuable rather than just transaction work. So that's what we did with Carrot. Was we said predictable, consistent income, valuable asset, SaaS business, software as a service, is that. You get paid monthly or annually. It's very easy to plan it. Let's build the best possible product we can to solve this need that I know we can solve really well as possible. And then the last one was kind of something we've talked about a little bit, but live on purpose and work on my unique abilities. So we've talked about living on purpose quite a bit. Wake up every day knowing what you're doing that day matters. Not just to your client, but to the world, that you're going to do something that day that actually creates a butterfly effect of creating the positive change you want to see. Even if it's making a Facebook post that gets in front of your 200 friends that is going to inspire them that day to share that, to be nicer to people. You know, it doesn't matter. Find something that is your purpose. And it doesn't have to be this grandiose thing like Elon Musk of getting humans to Mars. It can literally be, I've met some people that their purpose is just to be kind because they know that kindness rubs off on people. It's so amazing. There's a guy, Leo, I'm going to totally butcher his last name, but Leo Lagathis or something like that. He has a Netflix series called The Kindness Diaries.
Huh.
And it's amazing. Dude, you should check it out. It's amazing. And he goes around the world on this motorcycle, basically meeting people and finding the kindness in the world because he believes that kindness can change the world and that everyone, you know, there's kindness all around you. You just have to go find it. And if you can be it, it inspires other people to be more kind. The world becomes a better place. And I had a chance to interview him with my younger brother 4, 5, 6 months ago. And we've talked since then. And my brother collaborated on him on a t-shirt with him. My brother has a clothing business. And getting to know Leo man, it's like, kindness is his purpose. So it doesn't have to be this big grandiose thing. Simplify it and get excited about it. And then that last part of number five, unique abilities. This is the thing going all the way back to the start of this call. I was talking about, I was doing all these things in my day that I was pretty darn good at and they made me money. And therefore I thought that I should do more of those things. But I kept on hearing this term called unique abilities pop up. Friends of mine would say, hey, you know, there's a lot of phrases for it. Unique abilities, your superpower, your unique genius. I've heard all those phrases for the same thing. And this one thing helped hit home. This is in 2012, like this same year. I went through a coaching program called Strategic Coach. And one of the things that they help you do is hone in on your unique abilities. And I bought the book. It was a $20 book the year before. I thought that was going to solve it for me. It didn't. Once I was there live, the lady asked me a simple question that was probably written in the book. I think it was just timing. And I had to hear it at a certain time for it to hit me. She said, you know, unique abilities are the things that you're not only good at. I mean, you could potentially be world class at these if you really dove in and focused on them. But they give you more energy when you're done with them than when you started. They give you energy. Your unique abilities should. And I went back through the list of things I was doing that year. And I created something in 2012 I today called the energy audit. And I still do it to this day. I walk my team members through with it. I've got a a link up on my website, actually, where you can download the energy audit.
I'd love to link to that because I was going to ask you, I'm intrigued by the concept.
Yeah, I'll get you the link, Ed, and you can put it somewhere.
Yeah, I'll put it in the show notes. I'll include it here. So that's awesome. That's something I've paid a lot of attention to over the past few years. It's this idea, and Dan Sullivan got me in it. Same thing, a strategic coach. Mm-hmm. For a long time, and this is something freelancers really struggle with because we're supposed mm-hmm. to wear all the hats, right? We got to do all these different things, and we assume that we're supposed to be good at all of them. And there were aspects of my work that I hated, and I just felt bad about it. I wouldn't talk to anybody about it because I just felt, well, I'm supposed to be doing that. I'm supposed to be good at it. And my life changed, my business changed when I was honest with myself. And then I stopped feeling bad about the fact that, you know, out of all these things, I'm probably good at three of them. And there's a big group that I'm okay at. And there's a big group that I suck, totally suck mm-hmm. at doing. And mm-hmm. I just try to really shift more of my life and attention to the things that I'm really good at.
Dude, and it's such a big deal. And I want everyone listening to this podcast to really zero in on this. And in the second part of that, because like I said, I was so focused in on what am I good at? What am I not good at? And trying to outsource the things I wasn't good at. But for me, the part that really hit home with me at that time was the energy side of it, because I was doing things I thought I was pretty good at because they made money and that people liked it. They would come to me saying, you're very good at these things. So I trapped myself into thinking everyone says I'm good at them. I'm pretty good. It looks like they're working. Therefore, that's what I need to be doing more of. But when I would really go through this energy audit, and I'll give you guys a link, you'll link it up, but you guys can all do this right now. Grab a piece of paper. And I know this podcast is running a little bit longer than your normal ones, but hopefully this is good value for everyone.
Then we'll
wrap it up. Good. So grab a piece of paper, blank piece of paper, draw a line right down the middle of that thing vertically. Okay. Right down the middle of it. And on the left side, write gives energy or gives me energy or something like that. On the right side of that line, write drains energy. Okay. And then at the bottom, like right below that vertical line at the very bottom, do a little dash mark and a percentage and then a dash mark and a percentage. Basically just put some spots so you can fill in your percentage here in a second. Now go through that, and on the left side, you know, take 5, 10, 15 minutes, whatever it's going to take, and look back at your last week, your last 2-3 weeks, and write down the activities that you have been doing that give you energy, that when you're done doing them, you're fired up, you have more energy. When you started podcasts like this, give me energy. I wasn't doing any podcasts or any training in 2012. I had a business partner who was the front of the business. I was behind. Therefore, these things that gave me energy, I was doing none of them because I didn't see how we were going to make money doing it because I was the guy behind the business. And then on the right side, write all the things that drain your energy. You know, what are the things that just drain your energy? This isn't just in business. So on the energy side, write the things that even if you're not doing them, that they give you energy. Working out gives me energy. There's a lot of things that give you energy. Write those things on the left side because those are life energy things, not just business side things. And even if you're not doing them at all, especially if you're not doing them, write those things down. And the right side, the things that zap your energy. And then go through, and at the bottom of that, do a ratio. You go, okay, right now, every week is about 80%, you know, drains energy, 20% gives me energy. That's what my ratio was in 2012. And when I actually went down that list, I'm like, whoa, well, most of my week is actually these things on the right. Very little is these things. I don't even know how I'm going to make money doing these other things, just being strategic but not implementing. You know, going out there and speaking and coaching on entrepreneur things when I don't have products to sell for that. All these things I was making excuses for. These give me energy, but I don't see how I'm going to do them in my business, current business. That was a fallacy I had. I was trying to wrap these into my current business model and make money. And so you'll have those ratios. Your goal should be to be over 60% energy work every week, for sure. If you're under 50%, you're going to be miserable. You're going to be depressed. And this energy audit is a quick way to, if you're depressed or feeling like your momentum's heading the wrong direction, do an energy audit. My guess is you're well above 50% of your time draining energy. The last part, now this is where the magic came in. And this I actually put in a couple years ago. This wasn't original. The last part is now that you've got that list and you've got your ratio, set your goal for over the next year to two. If you're 80% and drains energy and 20% the other way, or 50-50 or whatever, set a goal where every quarter you're going to increase the amount of work every week that is energy work. And what I do is every quarter I take that list, and on the right side I circle 1, 2, 3 things, that I want to get rid of the most, that zap my energy the most. I write down how many hours per week I'm spending on them. So I just did it here just recently, and there were two items that were about 7 to 8 hours a week that together I was doing them, but they really drained my energy. I circled them. I go, okay, I'm going to get rid of those this quarter. I go to the left side and I find one or two activities that give me energy. And I go, okay, which one of these am I going to add this quarter? And that's what I do. In that quarter, the first things I tackle that quarter before I do any of my other task work is how do I get rid of these energy drains to add that one that gives me energy? And now my energy work is about 85, 15 every week, most weeks, not every week, most weeks. And I can tell you business is way more fun. It's way more on purpose. You can focus a lot better when you're focusing on doing stuff you really enjoy and it gives you energy. And it actually unlocks why we became entrepreneurs in the first place. So I'll leave it with that. And I can talk about this topic for hours, man.
I love that. You know, and you made it actionable, because it's one thing to identify and get that clarity, but it's another to say, okay, how do I shift? How do I start shifting? Yep. And I love the simplicity of just highlighting the ones that that you want to get rid of. And I think that intention alone will set you on the right path, right? Because you may not know exactly how that moment, but if you keep looking at it, you will find ways to get rid of them.
Yep, exactly.
I love it.
Exactly.
I love it. Trevor, this has been eye-opening. I love what you shared. You've really inspired me, especially this time of year, just to sit down. And I don't have these non-negotiables. I'll be honest with you. I'm going to borrow some of what you have here, and I'm going to put some of my own, because I've already, just listening to you, I've thought of some things that, you know what, these are definitely non-negotiables. It's not on your list, but it's unique to me, or it's more personal. And I encourage everyone to do the same. I mean, I use these as inspiration. And this is the time, you know, there's no better than today, right? To start clarifying these intentions and being very clear about what you're not going to do and what your business will be about and what direction you want to move in. So thank you for not just inspiring us, but sharing these concrete ideas with us. I want to make sure, and I want to make sure before we leave, though, that you tell us where folks can find out more about you. We'll make sure to include these links in the show notes, but where can I send people?
Yeah, man. So our software company is called Carrot. So you can find us at oncarrot.com. We have a blog over there that we publish a lot of content on, but also I pull away and usually publish about once a month on kind of behind the scenes business stuff. And my podcast is probably if you guys liked anything that was talked about here, even though our podcast is focused on the real estate side of things, probably well over half of my episodes are not real estate specific at all. It's me talking about things exactly like this that I'm passionate about. So find the Carrot Cast on iTunes, follow that and pick the episodes that are not real estate specific. And I think you'll be able to get a lot of takeaways from it.
That's fantastic. Thank you, Trevor. And we'll make sure to include links to the podcast. And man, I appreciate you sharing all this with us today.
Likewise, dude, I appreciate the invite. And this one thing I want to finish with is everyone listening to this, just remember why you became an entrepreneur or freelancer in the first place. Okay. Don't let your business box you in. Make sure that you're creating the business that matches exactly where you want to go in life. And in business success and happiness is just as much focusing on what you are not going to do as it is on what you are going to do. So use the energy at it, go out there, create your non-negotiables, and let me know how I can help.
The High Income Business Writing Podcast is a production of B2B Business Launcher. Learn more at b2blauncher.com.
Hopefully you enjoyed that conversation with myself and Ed on his podcast, on the High Income Business Writing Podcast. And if you're new to the Carrot Cast, the reason I put this podcast in here, which has nothing to do with real estate investing and everything to do with kind of tearing the walls down behind the way I think about business and the way I think about consulting, the way we've really grown this business, and also mindset things, is some of my best ideas in business have came from listening to things outside of my industry, from listening to people in other types of businesses, what's working for them, and then bringing it into my life and my business. And we do that all the time. We're always looking for inspiration. And one of the reasons I join masterminds, especially masterminds where they're not specifically drilled down to just what we're doing, real estate or whatever, is we want to surround ourselves with people in different types of businesses. So I'm in a mastermind right now. There's a lot of people in it. And there's people that are fitness trainers. There's people in there that are financial planners. There's real estate investors, one of the biggest real estate agents in the country. You can go on down the line, publishers, trainers, software company owners. And I can tell you that as entrepreneurs, we all have very, very similar struggles. There's always very similar things that can work in marketing. And some of my best ideas and inspiration came from someone who, you know, was in the fitness industry, and I can apply this over here, or in the financial planning industry, I can apply this marketing method over here. So we're going to be introducing more of that kind of stuff in the Carrot Cast, where we're going to be collecting the best of the best from other industries and showing you how you can apply it to cut through the clutter this year and to win your market. And also, if you're not a subscriber to the Carrot Cast, I want you to do this. Now take 15 seconds, go over to iTunes and hit that subscribe button, because each and every week we're rolling out a new episode. We're actually going to be talking about rolling out two episodes a week, one that's going to be a drilled down less than 10 minute nugget you can implement every single week in your business for your marketing. And then the other one is going to be the style. It's the interview. It's the Trevor Truck Talks, things like that. So let us know your feedback. If you think that idea is great, just send me an email at trevor@oncarrot.com and let me know if you like that idea. If so, if we get enough of those, we'll send it through. And also, people who are subscribed to the podcast get first access to each and every Carrot Cast by about a week. Okay, we publish them on our blog about a week after we release them on iTunes, which means anyone who wants to join our contest, we give away lots of books and we give away lots of other things. Those are always time sensitive. It's usually the first 10, first 20 people to take action on that thing, get the free book, get the free coaching session, whatever it is. And those are always gone before we ever email it to the blog. So if you want to make sure your first one's in, go to subscribe to it. And also, please, 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 we want to get over 100. At the time that I'm recording this, we're just under 100 reviews on iTunes. And even if you hate the podcast, let me know what we can do better. But go over to iTunes, help us push over that 100 mark. Help us push over the 100 mark. I think we need 5 or 6 more. And if you head over there and there's less than 100, please pop in what you get out of the podcast, what you love about it, and also give me some feedback on what we can improve upon, and that would help me immensely. Help us over 100, y'all. All right, have an amazing rest of the week. We're so glad that you invested your time with us here on this podcast, and please go follow Ed. Ed's got a great podcast if you're interested in writing at all. He's the guy. All right, have an amazing week. Talk soon.